Okay, well, greetings. Hi. Okay, so now the I guess the first thing I must ask is, did anybody solve the main problem that we were left with on Thursday? Or does anybody remember what the main problem was that we, you know, where did we leave off? What was the what was the missing link that we had to join? Yeah, Anya?
We had conjectured that there were only a small number of infinite classes of monotonic squares and decimal.
Right, and so the missing link was to prove the conjecture, is that right? Okay. So now we had also, in fact, we even had proved that those infinite classes were legitimate. At least we had, we proved the hardest one in the other. There were four classes, I think. So let's remind ourselves of that. On that, anyway, we had. I like Ramsey's notation for that. We had 1, 6, star, 7, where the star means 0 or more, and then we had 3, star, 4, 3, star, 5, and then we had the amazing one. Life would be a lot easier if it didn't exist, but it does. All 3, star, 6, star, 7, which is any number of 3s, any number of 6s, and a 7. Okay, and then we had a bunch of sporadic solutions that you could easily check were correct, and 38 was the one that I gave in the problem statement, turned out to be one of those ungeneralizable ones. And in fact, I guess I chose it. I didn't know about all these solutions, but I knew that 38 was not generalizable, at least, and I knew of two of the infinite classes, or I guess I think I knew a special case of this one. Okay, so now it's not hard to prove by using the rep unit idea that we had on Thursday that these actually do exist, but the missing link was that none other work. And so we have to. So if only there weren't these infinite classes, then the computer program that gave us this conjecture would have ground out all the answers, and then we'd be done with it. But here now we have in every case the computer would keep on running and would say, you know, well, when if you have 6 7s in a row, then you can't have a 2 in front of it. What if you? I mean, sorry, 6 6s in a row. What if you have 10 6s in a row? Then you can't. Then 2 6 with 10s in it, 7 isn't a solution. But in fact, what was happening was that that computer program that gave us these conjectures was trying in all of these cases. You know, you start out. It had a live possibility. Any number of 3s followed by a 4, and it tried to put a 2 in front of that. And it didn't succeed, and it tried to put a 1 in front of it and didn't succeed, and so the question is, how can we write a program that's going to carry out those infinitely many calculations of things that didn't succeed? We've seen how to make a proof of infinitely many cases that do succeed. Now we've got to do the harder thing, infinitely many things that fail. And usually disproving things is harder than proving things. You know, to prove that there are that a problem is unsolvable or something like that, that you can't solve a fifth degree equation, that you can't express pi as a solution to a polynomial equation, things like that. Those impossibility proofs are typically more difficult than a proof that something is possible. Show that, you know. So anyway, this is not quite as hard as that kind of impossibility proof. But so does anybody have an idea how to crack this? Roger.
Well, we've got a couple of pumping lemmas here.
Ah, you have some pumping lemmas. That's interesting.
What you get, let me know.
So you've got a sheet of paper here?
A sheet of paper on. And if I like the notation that I originally wrote it down in, but essentially, if you've got some stuff at the beginning followed by a bunch of repeated digits plus some stuff at the end. If the stuff at the beginning and the stuff at the end are sufficiently short, then you can repeat, then what you get by squaring the whole thing is going to have the same digits in it as whatever you get by squaring something with it.
Oh, okay. So now you want to get a good formula for the case of let's see now, how did you write this?
Forget the one on the bottom.
This is where it says lemma here?
No?
Okay, so first of all, you've got a general base beta. Let's take base 10 and first of all, be more concrete. Probably. Aha. Theorem, pumping lemma. Okay. Given things as above. Okay, here we go. First of all, I'm going to need to look above here, right? So let beta, gamma, and delta be as above.
Okay, beta is the base.
Beta is the base, so I'll just take 10 for the heck of it.
Just an integer such that beta minus 1 divides gamma squared. So that's like the idea is that in base 10.
Gamma equals 3.
Gamma is 3.
Okay. And delta is?
Delta is what's left over when you divide gamma squared by beta minus 1. Base 10 is 1. Don't worry about it.
Oh, okay. So delta is 1, beta is 10. Okay. So now. Here's what you say. If 3a is less than 10, is that your theorem? Gamma a is less than beta.
Gamma a is a digit. That's some digit that's a multiple of 3.
Right, but it has to be less than 10.
Well, it's just that it has to be a digit. Okay.
Yeah, single digit. Okay. Okay, so now here, gamma 3a is less than 10, like that. Okay, so it's either, in other words, it's a multiple, it's 3 or 6 or 9. Okay, or 0. Now, here you say C times 10 to the n plus 3a r sub n plus b squared is sorted. If and only if, that's a nice kind of a result. C times 10 to the m plus 3a r sub m plus b squared is sorted.
For is sorted, you can substitute.
M greater than or equal to 2 plus max.
Okay, lambda, there's the number of digits.
All right. Okay, so it's sort of 3 plus max of log 10 of B and C. Okay. 3 plus the floor of the log of max B and C. Like that.
Because lambda has a 1 in it.
Oh, I see. Lambda B plus lambda. Oh, I see. I didn't write it for me. Anyway, for all MN sufficiently large, right?
It's a function of the number of digits in B and C.
Okay. So for all n greater than or equal to, for all n greater than or equal to some capital N depending on B and C. So now let's take a look at this. And it says that, three a r sub n, this is the case then when we have threes and sixes repeating, which is the case that we're interested in. Okay. And so now B and C are our beginning and ending corrections to the thing, and so this is saying that that all we have to do is go up to a certain point, and then we've we got the problem solved. Oh, this is.
That only handles single repeated digits. There's another one that has to handle that you need to handle double two repeated digits.
Right. And so in order to satisfy the 3, 6, 7 condition, yeah. But this is a big advance if we can prove something like this. So this is let's see. Now I would like to okay. In general, you discovered this by considering a more general thing, that the base was beta, right?
Well, I started out
with that. Three was a divisor of. The beta minus one was a square or something like that. Something more general, anyway. Now, I would like to suggest that. The following slight change in terminology that might simplify things a little bit, and that is let's let Q sub n equals 3 R sub n. Now this is a small step, but it simplifies our formula slightly. I'll explain why in a minute. The reason is that Q sub m, well, I'm going to write some down and then erase it in a minute because it's going to be so quick. But we're going to, Q sub m is equal to 10 to the n, is equal to 10 to the n minus 1 over 3, while R sub n was 10 to the n minus 1 over 9. And the reason why I think Q's are important or helpful in this kind of simplification is just like what we did on Thursday, and that we have an easy way to multiply Q sub m times Q sub n. That's equal to 10 to the m plus n minus 10 to the m minus 10 to the n plus 1 over 9. And so this comes out to be equal to R sub m plus n, if we take away a 1 there. And then, of course, we have to add back in a 1. So R sub n plus n minus R sub m minus R sub n. So there's a way to multiply Q's and get R's. And that's and the R's are the things that we need for sortedness, and the Q's are... So that 3 will... So I just write that formula down as a basic multiplication formula. Qm Qn is R m plus n minus Rm minus Rn, and let's see it even. Well, yeah. So that's possibly valuable. Okay. So let's look at Rogers' lemma there now, and see. What we got to do is expand out the two sides, right? So, here's what the formula is.
Well, that's the formula that happens to be square.
Okay. Well, yeah. So let's work out the square of this thing. It's a function of m of n, and let's see if we can get something that's that dependence on n only matters for all large n is the same. So c times 10 to the n. So we square that thing. Let's get another formula for 10 to the m q n. 10 to the m q n. See if we can figure out what that is. 10 to the m times 10 to the n minus 1 over 3 is equal to 10 to the m plus n minus 10 to the m over 3. So what's that come out to be? If Q's and R's are the this thing. What do we get for that?
Should we have it as qm plus n minus qn, is it?
Yeah. Qm plus n minus qm. I think I did it right. So it gives us an algebra that we can, you know, that we can easily build into a machine if we had to, or we can easily do by ourselves if we have to do a lot of these calculations. Okay. So now we got this rule. Now let's see. So we can multiply this out. So this is c squared times 10 to the 2n.
So it's probably easier to just leave 10 to the m qn as it is.
It's not. I see. You don't recommend actually using this
yeah,
nice.
Okay, fine.
C squared 10 to the 2n plus 2ac times 10 to the n. Actually, we have a coincidence. There's n and n, so that might be easier too. Let's see, 9 terms altogether. So I got a squared times qn squared, which
there you want to
reduce
one.
There I do. R sub 2n minus 2rn. Is that right?
You don't want to use that. Oh, I was just saying, when you want to figure q squared, you should make one of the q's be 10 to the 3 times 10 to the 10 to the n minus 1 minus 3 over 10 to the n minus 1 over 3.
Oh, okay. So you've got instead of applying my handy dandy formula, you've got a better formula that's going to work with powers of 10 in there. So yeah, but let me multiply it out and play with it some more. But I got to get let's see. So I'm hung up on Q's and R's, I guess. So B squared, then there's a 2BC 10 to the N, and a 2AB Q sub N. All right. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 terms out of there. Okay, so now I'm done expanding it, except you gotta simplify it. And so you wanted to combine things so that we could see something about sortedness. Okay, now R2n minus Rn we can recognize as a power of 10 times...
That should be... All right.
What do you recommend for that one? I mean, this...
Well,
one of the things is true is that that R2n minus Rn is equal to 10 to the n Rn. I don't know if that helps any.
You want to get things in terms of Rn's and 10 to the n Rn's.
Okay. So I've got a minus. Do I want to get rid of minus signs too? Is the point?
No, that's okay.
That's okay.
The idea is you want to break the square up into, you've got the last n digits, which is going to be r some multiple of rn plus something, and then the next to the last n digits is going to be 10 to the n, some multiple of 10 to the n rn plus something times 10 to the n, and then you're going to have something times 10 to the 2n.
Okay, so 10 to the 2n is okay.
Yeah.
But r sub 2n is not okay.
No, R sub 2n is...
I mean, I'd rather not have R sub 2n in my formula.
You want to turn it into an Rn 10 to the n.
Yeah, okay. So let's get rid of the R sub 2n by calling that 10 to the n Rn minus Rn. Because I had R sub 2n minus two of them. I've only got one left. I got rid of R 2n minus Rn. And now there's another negative Rn that was still there. All right, now. And so now, are we ready? Are you?
You can do things.
Okay, so now let's take a look and see if we can see it. Is this sorted or is this not sorted?
Well, don't worry about whether it's sorted. Just look at, if you just group things, I'll rewrite it first, and that'll be a little clearer.
Okay, so so first of all, you've got a 10 to the 2n times c squared, and then a 10 to the n rn. Is that what you want as another term?
Yeah, everything that's a multiple 10 to the n rn.
10 to the n rn. Okay, now.
Well, actually, no. 10 to the n, everything is a multiple 10 to the n. I'm sorry. Put the rn inside the parentheses.
Oh, okay. 10 to the n times. Okay, then there's an rn and a.
Well, rn a squared.
Okay, so here we get. So 10 to the n rn a squared. Here's a 6 AC. All right, and then.
And then there's a 2 BC at the end.
Okay. Systematically.
No, 2 BC times 10 to the n.
Right. So I finished the RN times 10 to the n, guys. This was a 6, believe it or not. Looks like a B. And then this is a plus 2 BC
and then everything else,
and then we got a okay, so now I got the R sub n times 6ab minus a squared from these terms, plus b squared. Okay.
Now, I have a little lemma for multiplying things by r to the n. What you get when you multiply something by r to the n is, again, some junk in the front, a bunch of repeated digits, and then some junk at the end. But it's...
Oh, okay, yeah, that's... the question is, what do you get if you have if somebody tells you like I've now got 1009 r to the n, what is that equal to, right? Is that in decimal notation?
Yeah, it's if you just write down it's some number times 10 to the n plus a digit times r to the n plus that same minus that same number that you multiply by.
Okay, so let's go to that subproblem then. That's interesting. I'm giving you a chance to say more than three things, you notice, this time, because this is a honorary breakthrough of the theory here. What's going on now? See, we got rn times k or something like that.
RN times K equals.
All right. Does K have to be small or large, or doesn't matter?
Anything.
Okay.
Is some number L times 10 to the n.
All right.
Minus a digit times R, plus a digit times R to the n. Minus L.
Okay. And for some L and D, depending on K, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So let's see what these L and D's are.
Well, D is.
Let's let somebody else figure out what L and D are. So we'll try to get a function L of K and D of K. I love that notation. That's my initials. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, has anybody figured out this? What?
D is the sum of the digits of K.
D is the sum of the digits of K. All right. Well, now, for example, R of K, Rn happens to be equal to. I think
there will be. You have some carries.
Mm-hmm.
But don't have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, what? Look at what, well, okay, remember what R sub n is.
Maybe if you just write R sub n in terms of it's 10 to the n.
Minus 1 over 9, right.
Yeah.
So multiply both sides by 9.
Yeah.
And you get 10 to the n minus 1 k is equal to 10 to the n minus 1 l of k plus 9 l of k plus d of k. So that gives us an idea as to something that L of K and D of K ought to satisfy. K has to equal 9 L of K plus D of K. So it's a D of K seems to be related to the sum of the digits of K. It looks as though it's the remainder dividing by 9, although I'm not sure if you want to use 9 in the case K is equal to 9, presumably we do. So, is that right? So the formula then is that D of K, it looks like here, D of K is, you throw away multiples of 9 out of K, and then you're left with D of K. So the question is, what about the difference between d of k equal to 0 and d of k equal to 9? Well, if d of k is equal to 0, then subtracting l of k off is going to lead to carries and borrows and stuff like that. So let's put d of k to be the remainder of k mod 9, but we take the high remainder instead of the low remainder, the remainder between 1 and 9. That's also known as, so D of K could also be written as something like K minus 1 mod 9 plus 1, something like that. If we have to use the mod notation. And then L of K is equal to the K minus 1 divided by 9, probably something like that. Every time we get up, you know, when we get to 10, we want it to be 1. When we get to 19, we want it to be 2, and so on. So anyway, that's a formula then that will show us that any multiple of R, it depends on we're going to get a pattern that has a lot of D's in it. And then we're going to have an L up here and a minus L down here. So the minus L is going to mess up some of the D's, but if N gets large enough, then the D's are going to all survive, and you'll be able to see them. Okay? So the moral of this story is then that if n is large enough, we'll be able to the only difference between rn times k and for large n will be the length of the string of d's. Everything else is going to remain constant, but the d's are going to expand over and over again. Okay, so that gives the basis for proving infinitely many things, because we get it reduced to a number of cases. So now, okay, what do we got here then? We got 10 to the 2n times c squared. I can erase this because I expanded it. So 10 to the 2n c squared, that's, so now if I got 2n digits here, I guess I'll let Ramsey figure out how to do this with tech. Put some braces like that, you know, an N here, digits. Okay, so now let's see, what do we got? We got C squared there, and then we've got RN, times some constant here plus 2bc. So this is, there's going to be some sort of L1 and D's coming in here, and something messing it up down in that position, depending on these coefficients and these coefficients. So there's something. Let's put all the D's in here, and then just add some, I don't know what to call it, remainder or something, R1 here. So there's D1s all the way across here, and then an R1. So the R1 corresponds to the fix-up according to the minus L in that multiplication theorem plus the 2BC. And then we've got Rn times this constant, so there'll be an L2 here and a bunch of D2s in this place, and then we have another bunch of glitches down here, R2. It's going to mess up the bottom digits. Okay, now let's see. If this is a negative number, then I'm not sure about our theorem. We have to consider negative case too. Suppose I'm subtracting a whole bunch of R's off of here. I think that'll still, conceptually this will still work. That is, our final answer now is going to then have a fixed part here where the carrying rules that occur in this part of the arithmetic are going to be the same no matter what n is. And this is just going to be a bunch of D1s, and this is going to be a bunch of D2s. That's going to get larger and larger. Okay. So now the intuition as to how this result could be true is becoming more clear, and it just managed to make a formal proof that actually carries out all the details, but the basic structure here now begins to look very, it's believable, because this formula, when we write it out and see what it would look like, it's got to be formed by the process of ordinary addition that we understand since fourth grade, and we can see that the carries are only going to come along a certain way, and then after that point, and we've got a bunch of D's in here, and similarly, then we get an unknown part of the pattern here, but that's going to eventually wind up with the D1. We can even see what D1 is. It's the remainder of this thing mod 9. And D2 is, if this is positive, it's the remainder mod 9. Otherwise, we'd have to think about it, because we'll have to borrow in something from the I don't want to have a negative number here. Suppose, imagine that this was negative and I was subtracting it from the other side. Still, we would get a string of equal digits in there. Okay, Randy?
Where DNA came from, B will be greater than A.
Excuse me?
From where DNA came from, that original formula.
Ah, right.
B will be greater than A, so you'll never have it.
B will be greater than A. B? No.
B will be greater than 3A.
In this case,
if you assume that
B is 1, B is 1.
Right.
So it looks like it's positive, in fact. Yeah, let's take a look at the... Yeah, so here we got A equals 2. B is 1, and still 6B is greater than A. Here we got A equals 1, B equals 1, A equals 1, B equals 2, and here we've got the other case. Alright, so now the first three cases, it looks as though then the the computer can safely have a cutoff on how far a string of A's or three A's it's supposed to consider.
Well,
before it, yeah, Andy?
The 3-star, 6-star, 7 case should follow just from this one something number, because once you prove essentially that the number of sixes doesn't matter, you can take as however many you want, and then go on and prove that the number of threes in front of that doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's an interesting thought. So now, can we prove that there the next case? That's a really interesting.
It's
observation, and some people are shaking their heads violently, but it's not obviously wrong, but it would take some tricky thing. Arif?
Well, in this case, we have always assumed that N, the number of digits in Qn is sufficiently larger than the number of digits in B.
There exists an n of BC.
If you take the number of sixes to be arbitrarily large,
mm-hmm.
then you can't find a cutoff to which you have to actually prove things for the number of.
It looks as though if for example the number of threes is 2 to the n and the number of sixes is n. Then we can switch it. Okay, so, yeah, what if, yeah.
Well, I mean, you either add threes on the left or I start with a bunch of threes and add threes on the right.
Okay, yeah.
3-star, 6-star.
Okay, so you're saying that you could either consider, if the number of threes is way bigger than the number of sixes, then you take B to be, to incorporate the sixes. Is that right?
Well,
you take this guy to incorporate the sixes and A is equal to 1.
Right.
If you have a lot more sixes than threes, then you put them into C, and you work out this formula here. But now, what if? So the extreme cases are covered, and that's gives confidence, but.
There's still some more things which have to be checked out. It may be possible that it's still
that's right.
It seems to me you're just up with a finite number of cases that you can't prove with this lemma. I mean, you just take the number of six is equal to n of bc, and there's no point in extending it after that, because you know that whatever you can stick in front of that, you can stick in front of that.
I think it would be very interesting to see if exactly to what extent this lemma and no other. You know, no looking at the under the table of the proof. You know, once we have a formula for the n, which is something like log of bc, which is, you know, the number of digits in b and c is where is what's involved here, not the actual size of b and c. It would be interesting to see how that could be beefed up. On the other hand, if we know the proof of the lemma, and it also strikes me that the same idea will probably may very well work for the proof of the general case. I mean, namely, try to write the formula out for the square of this guy, and see what happens. Now that one would be a formula that looks like C times 10 to the let's say M plus Q M plus Q N plus B squared, where M is let's say greater than or equal N. So I get this, so that C is known to be great. So this would account for threes, and you know, this would count for M minus N threes and N sixes going to the right. Now when you get a an expansion of that formula. It might be possible, since we know how to multiply QM, QN, and get R's, it might be possible to see that there are strings of digits that are going to be the same for all large enough M and N to that condition. Have to write it out and see. But you tried it, Roger?
Well, I've got something along those lines, but what it says is that you have to pump M and N simultaneously.
That is, both M and N have to be large.
No? They have to be, there is a bound for, yeah, they both have to be greater than a certain number, and what it says, all it relates is
if they both move basically lockstep.
Yeah, they're.
You have to use what you expect because you get different patterns if M is, if the number of threes is different, larger than number six.
Okay, that's let's explain. Do you remember the thing that we proved first of all that this pattern worked on Thursday, we had a formula that for the square that let's remind ourselves of that formula. What was it? Something like Q M. Well, like I might as well just work that one out. Q M plus Q N plus one squared is equal to Q squared Q M squared, which is R Q M minus two R M. Plus QN squared, which is R2N minus 2RN, plus 1, plus 2 QMQN, which is RM plus N minus RM minus RN, and 2 QM, which is 6 RM and 6 RN, like that. Now if I've done this correctly, okay, this and this cancel with this, this and this cancel with this, and so we got nine R's. Okay, so that's what the square is there, and let's suppose that I make the statement that M is greater than or equal N or something, but now, this one gives us 2M ones. This one gives us 2n ones. This gives us 1. Here we got m plus n, and who knows what about m plus n? It might be bigger than 2n or not. No, m is greater than or equal to n. That one's okay. No, with two n. We're comparing N to M, so this is bigger. So that's okay. And I see, it's these two guys. N is certainly less than 2N. But now RM, that's the missing one. I'm not sure where M fits into this. This I did these in the opposite order. So for the first terms here, I happen to know the relative lengths of these guys. This one is definitely less than this one, is definitely less than or equal this one, less than or equal this one, less than or equal this one. But this guy doesn't. I'm not sure where it fits. And this is m minus n is the number of threes, and m minus and 2m minus n is something like. Oh, what is it? The number of sixes is this guy minus this guy. It depends as to whether or not in the answer, as I recall, fives come up in some cases and not in others. If you got more threes than sixes, you get fives in the square, and otherwise you don't get fives. It's a matter of so this guy is a maverick that we're not sure where he fits in with respect to the other ones, and so the number the pattern of digits that you get is different for large M and N, depending on what, which, on the relative sizes of these things. So how could you have a pumping lemma that would say it was the same? It would have to be, you would have to consider two cases, at least. One is the case where the number of threes is greater or equal to the number of sixes, and one where the number is less than or equal to the number of sixes, because then we would have some hope for a pumping lemma of the stated form. Okay. How are we doing on time? I'm trying to pace myself.
Okay.
Well, let's see now. What other approaches have people used so far over the time? Let's get Anil, you had some printout here.
Oh yeah. Well, I was trying to get a confirmation of the fact that there are not any other infinite classes.
Mm-hmm.
And I generated monotonic squares and tried to terminate classes of monotonic squares by adding things on the left using the following criterion for knowing that you couldn't add further things on the left.
Mm-hmm.
And our group called that the suffix test, and it goes like this. If you have a number of n digits and you square it, and the last n digits of the square is...
I don't know how to do this. Wait a minute. Okay. So you say if you have a number of n digits...
Yeah. And you square it.
Yeah.
And the last n digits of the square is non-monotonic.
Okay.
Then there's no way you can add things to the left of those n digits and get a monotonic square.
Okay. All right. So if, in other words, it precludes the rightmost digits of x have to be good if x is good.
Right.
It's something like the what they call in dynamic programming the principle of optimality, that you have, if you have a solution to the problem, all of the smaller subproblems have to also be solutions, and then you focus in on a solution in that way.
Yeah. Okay. That turns out to be a fairly strong pruning criterion for just exhaustively searching this tree. And so what I did was building from the left up from the right and tacking things onto the left, extended things until I reached situations in which this suffix test was violated.
Yep.
Now certain strings of digits, though they didn't generate monotonic squares themselves, would never violate the suffix test, certain classes of infinite strings of digits. And for those...
For example,
if you take... A string of a large number of threes. A number of groups found the same, tried the same method, and found the same results. If you take, say, a number of threes, or a number of threes followed by an eight.
Okay, threes followed by an eight.
For example.
Uh-huh.
More than one three followed by an eight.
Right.
And...
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. So
it turns out you can... never violates.
It seems to give you 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4. Something like that.
Something like
that. Well, I know 38 squared is 1, 4, 4, 4. Yeah.
It becomes 1, 4, 2, a number of 2s. Number of 1s, 4, number of 2s, and 4, 4 at the end.
Oh, I see. So after a while you start getting 2s.
Right.
Yeah.
4 in front of it.
And then a 4.
And 1s.
And then 1s.
Oh, okay.
But the last n digits are always 2s and 4 in sorted order.
Okay.
And so that never violates the suffix test, no matter how many threes you tack on to that.
Okay.
However, the square itself isn't monotonic. So you know that
right.
You must terminate it on the left by something other than a 3.
Okay. So then you have to try it.
So then you have to try a 2. Or.
Right.
Okay. And if you put a 2 on the end of them, then that violates the suffix test, turns out.
But a 1 is still okay.
A 1 doesn't doesn't immediately violate the suffix test, but
yeah.
It doesn't give you a monotonic square.
Yeah.
And then you're left putting another 1 in front, and that ends up violating the suffix
test. Okay. Oh, well, a 0 on the...
Yeah, you get a 0.
But a 0 you can consider as a cutoff point.
Okay. All right, that's good. That's a good... Now let's see... So first of all, the suffix test is a nicer way to say what we were talking about last week, where we said you've got a number so far, and then we're going to put an A in front of it, and then we're going to consider different kinds of A's. That's another. It's the same as the suffix test. It's just not. The suffix test is a nicer name for it.
The test that we used last time is a little bit stronger than the suffix test because we used some more. If you only use the suffix test to prune, then the string of nines is still a possibility.
A string of nines in the X or X squared?
In the X.
In X.
Still a possibility. At least Anil's program. Anil's program didn't prune it, did it?
I see. Well, in other words...
No. The last end digits remain sorted. You get zeros in there.
I see. You get I see.
If you use a slightly stronger suffix test. That looks for the zeros as well.
Yeah, zeros are a special case. Okay, so it's very much like that. Now the interesting things that there's a lot of neat stuff. I'm trying to get it so that we can do it in a short amount of time. This is let's take a look at one of these cases. So let's take the threes and the eights just in general and see what we do. So now in that case we would have something like 10 to the n times a, which a is the digit that's going to come before a string of threes, plus qn plus 5. Okay, and a is going to either be a 1 or a 2, let's say, or a 0, I suppose, but not a 3, and certainly not a 4. Okay, now, observed that this satisfies the suffix test for all n, and so we've got to put something in front of it and rule it out. Now, and suppose we haven't discovered this great pumping lemma, so we don't have the test saying that if there was a good one, it would exhibit itself for small n. That would be the gist of the pumping lemma. Well, let's get the let's do this one and see what we get. Okay, so now this is a squared times 10 to the 2n. I should get good at this by the time I'm finished here. Plus 2. Well, let's see. Qn squared. I'll square them all first. That's one way I can do it. Now I'll take the cross product term. So Qn squared is r2n minus 2rn, and then 5 squared is 25. And then I got 2a times 10 to the n Qn. Which I know is R2n minus Rn, and then I got 10a times 10 to the n, and then I got what's left is 10 Qn or 30r. Rn, I guess, is the best way to do that. And 10 to the n is, I could leave it as 10 to the n, or I could make it Rn plus 1 minus Rn, I don't know. But let's see, if I got, I've got 30 RNs in here, so that's enough to cancel a lot of negative RNs. So let me show you something that as an example of what's Rn plus 1, let's call this R2n plus 1 minus, is that any good? Yeah, that's okay, minus R2n. Okay, so now I got this whole thing expressed in terms of rep units. And I hope this does some good, but I think it will be all right. A squared R sub 2n plus 1 plus two a. Let's see. I'm looking at the r sub two n's now. R sub two n's doesn't look too good. Minus a squared plus one minus plus two a times r sub two n. And okay. Now let's see. R sub n's. There's an R sub n plus 1. So here's 10a R sub n plus 1. This is the way it is, so we're going to live with it. This is R sub n is times minus 2 minus 2a minus 10a plus 30. Okay. And then finally, there was a plus 25. Now, A is a really not a variable, it's a constant. We're trying this out for different values of A. So A is equal to, like when A is equal to 1, is one case. That's a 1 followed by a bunch of 3s followed by an 8. When A is equal to 2, that's another case. If I've done this correctly, we should be able to figure it out. Then when A is equal to 1, we get a certain thing. Let's suppose A equals 1. That's R2n plus 1 plus 2R2n plus 10Rn plus 1. And then we get 30 minus 12 minus 14 is 16, if I did it right. 16Rn. Plus 25. Now, the question is, is this sorted or not? And this led, then I was thinking about this yesterday and realized that these R's have some very nice properties. I wonder if any of you came along with a similar idea. He asked the following question. We observed on Thursday that a number is sorted if and only if you can express it as a sum of 9 or fewer R's. I think this is a nice characterization. This is a nicer characterization than being sorted. I mean, this is sort of a property that's mathematically tractable. It somehow is much more beautiful than saying the digits are sorted. Because it has interesting generalizations. So now the question comes: What if I take a number and I try to represent it as the smallest number of rep units? Suppose somebody gives me a number, 1,000, or 1,382. What is the smallest number of rep units that I can express this in? There's an interesting problem that I had seen before. For example, what's the smallest number of Fibonacci numbers that you can use to represent a certain number of n or something like that? Well, rep units are another kind of numbers that we might do it. And making change is an example that I used to use to teach programming. I think it's one of the neatest ideas for an early program in somebody's life is to say, well, I make change for a certain amount. And so if somebody, you know, if you've got to make up 67 cents in change and you say you have any number of pennies, nickels, dimes, and quarters, and maybe even half dollars. Anybody remember a half dollar? We give a certain number of coins and we say give change to a certain amount, but use the smallest number of coins that you can. And so suppose that we had coins that were, you know, we had a penny and we had an 11 cent piece and we had a 111 cent piece and then we had, the next case and so on. Those are the only coins that we had. We wanted to use the fewest coins. Now the interesting thing about coins in United States currency is that the greedy algorithm works for getting the fewest coins. The greedy algorithm, does anyone understand what I might mean by a greedy algorithm, John? Always take the largest coin that you can to reduce the total. So you start out and suppose for example that the coins are let's even give ourselves dollar bills. So we got 1, 5, 10, 25, 50, and 100 units. And we have to make up a number n. So we ask, is n greater than or equal to 100? If it's greater than or equal to 100, then we hand out a dollar bill, reduce n by 100, and repeat the process. If n is less than 100, then we go down to 50 and we ask for and we put out 50 until n is less than 50. Then we put out 25 until n is less than 25 until finally we put out 1s until n is less than 1, then n is 0 and we're done. Now, the claim is that this is the smallest number of coins that would reach the number n. Each time we only looked at the largest coin less than or equal n. I say it's interesting that the greedy algorithm works because it doesn't always work for all sets of coins. If somebody can give me an example where it wouldn't work. Mike?
If you had 4 cent coins.
If you had 4 cent coins.
8 cents change.
And you wanted to make 8 cents change, and you had both 4 cent and 5 cent.
4 cents.
Yeah, right. Or another way of saying is if we didn't have nickels, we wouldn't be able to do 30 cents the right way either, because three dimes would be the best way to make 30 cents instead of a nickel and a quarter. See, so that's a similar kind of thing. So there are systems of coinage that don't have this property that the greedy algorithm works. Well, the Fibonacci numbers turn out to work. Another system that always works is when every coin is a multiple of the previous coin. But the interesting thing is that rep units also work. If you try to express something as the smallest number of rep units, you can always find the largest R sub n that's less than or equal to n, and then subtract that and keep reducing it. The thing is there are relations between these R's, as we know. R sub n plus 1 is equal to 10 R sub n plus 1. And 1 is R sub 1. So there are different ways to represent the numbers, want to get a small way to do it. Well, but the interesting thing is that if you use the greedy algorithm, it's not too hard to see what kinds of numbers that you're going to get. And let's take a random example. Can somebody give me a number and we'll express in terms of ours? Let's see. Amy, give me a number. 2344. That's not, I'm sorry, your number isn't random. And give me, what?
283.
383? It's, okay, now why did you say that much? Okay, 383. Okay, now there's a, that's the random. Okay, that's all right. Now, okay, so now this is equal to R3 plus 50. Okay? And so 50, what?
3i3.
3i3, yeah. 3i3 plus 50. 50 is equal to 4r4, r2 plus 6, r1. Okay? All right, so that, and now I claim that that's the smallest number of R's that would make 383. Okay, now the, I don't know, there must be other ways to prove this, but since there were several ways to get at this, it is why I like why I liked it, because it seems to be more important if there are different ways to arrive at the result. Now, one of the things that you notice about this greedy algorithm and the R's is that if after I've taken away the largest R sub M, then the number I've got left is of course less than R sub M. And so how many R sub M minus 1's could I possibly take away? And so you see, so if I have, suppose I have N is less than R sub M, then N is, then what is the N divided by R sub, let's say N, R, M plus 1. Suppose N is bigger, is less than R sub M plus 1. So that says that N is less than or equal R sub M plus 1 minus 1. But that's equal to 10 R sub M. And so N over R sub M is less than or equal 10. So the most of any particular kind of coin that I'm ever going to use is 10. Furthermore, if I use exactly, if this equality holds here, if I use 10, then I'm done. Then I've come to the end of the thing. So it turns out that what the greedy algorithm gives you in terms of R's, it always gives you, for every coin, you get either 0 up to 9 of that coin or 10 of it. But if you use 10, then you go zeros all the way for all smaller coins. So this gives us a way this gives us another number system for representing all positive integers as sums of R's. And the digits in this number system are 0 to 9, just like in a decimal system, plus a 10. We allow ourselves a 10 digit if it's got zeros following all the way. So 383 in this number system was 3, 4, 6. Let's look at counting in this number system. And suppose I have I get 2, 9, 9, 9, 1, and I want to add 1 to that. Okay, add 1, that's easy. Change that digit to a 2. Add 1 a few more times, we finally get this up to a 10. Call it 8. Now, add 1 to that, and what happens? Well, 10, a plus 1 is 11, which is going to carry 1. So it'll change this to an A and give us a 0 here. Now, add 1 to that, and what do you get? Well, this is 10 of those plus 1. So what happens, what's the next in this sequence? Whatever this number is, this is, you know, this represents 2 R sub 5 plus 9 R 4, 9 R 3, 10 R 2, and 0 R 1. Add 1 to that, what's the coinage? I put a 1 here. However, I said that if I use A, it has to be followed by zeros all the way to the end. So Ari? A00, yeah. And then the next step is of course 29A01, but A, this rule is what we use for adding 1 when I have A is 10. So if I go from 10 and have 1 out there, then it carries over to the next case. So that would give me A000. So there's a lot of action when there's a string of nines going on. And then the next case, add one more to that, and you get 3, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay? Now we can continue counting, and then nothing much will happen until the 3 changes to a 4 and so on. But we have a number system, and this I claim is the smallest number of coins. Now the proof of, I haven't proved that it's the smallest number of coins, but since we have this characterization, we can prove it in the following way. Take any set of positive integers that add up to n. And so here, for example, is one such case. I have, I'm going to have to erase this. I'm not going to consider any numbers, any other kinds of a's. So here we got, I have a 1 here, and then I have a 2, and then I have 10 here, and a 16 here. What is 16?
G.
And then 25 is sitting here. I don't know what, that's Z or something now. It's a past Z. Anyway, this is, and a bunch of zeros in between, in a number system, in this number system. But it's certainly not the minimum number of R's, because I got, you know, values that are too big. So I want to reduce it, and one of the things that I know I can do is I should be able to replace, for example, 16 Rn. I should be able to take 10 of those Rn's and replace it by Rn plus 1's. And let me use real numbers here, 10, 16, 25. So now the 16 I can reduce to 6 if I add 1 to this guy, and if I subtract 1 from the 25. And this 11 I can reduce to a 1 if I add 1 to the previous and I subtract 1 over here. Is always going to cost you at most 9 coins. And so this is a method then for going from any sequence that has something greater than or equal to 10 to another sequence that has one less violation of that condition and has at most as many coins. So the number, total number of coins never gets bigger, and we can convert it by a sequence of these operations until we get to our canonical form that consists of all these only things up to 9, followed by maybe 1 10 at the very end. Now this 23, for example, we would get rid of and call that 2R2 plus 1. And so now the minimum number of therefore, and a computer could do this. The minimum number of R's to express this number is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 11, 12, 13, 14, bigger than 9. But that's what happens if you have a 1 followed by any number of 3's followed by an 8. You get something that takes 12 rep units to express, to represent for all large enough n. For all n, I guess it works for all n, because we'll never get a digit bigger than 9, even if we let n go to 0 there.
The problem is that although that number itself is not a monotonic square, it still passes that suffix test, and I don't have any other rule for telling me that I couldn't somehow extend it on the left and produce a monotonic square, or couldn't produce a monotonic square. So it actually takes me one more addition, one more prefix 1, to show that that can't lead to
right.
A class.
Yeah, this still hasn't proved the suffix. I mean, I've shown that if I have a 1 and then I put a 0 in front of it, then it has too many coins. It takes too many rep units that this can't possibly be sorted. But it still will pass the It still will pass that test. And so this probably doesn't solve the original computer problem that we had. But it does. I illustrated it primarily because. Whenever you work on a problem, you try to see you also should keep asking other questions and see, you know, what about this? And you might discover something else. I sat in on Matt Kahn's lecture in the art department last week, and he had a nice thing for his student. He said, you know, I'm sending you out on some of these projects to mine for silver, but if you find a few gold nuggets, you can bring those in too. The fact that the R's, that there was a way to characterize the smallest number of R's in a number intrigues me, even though it doesn't help me solve the sorting problem. And in fact, it might relate somehow to the pumping lemma and so on too. On Thursday, we'll try to wrap up the discussion then of problem one and see what other things you people discover by then. With the pumping lemma, as you can see, it justifies cutting your program off after a certain point. And the remaining challenge as far as finishing problem one would be to see if the pumping lemma can be generalized to the other case of threes and sixes and so on. You see, in other bases, I think what's going to happen is in base 17, there's going to be any number of fours followed by any number of eights followed by any number of 12s followed by a 13 is going to be monotonic square in that case. So if there's a, you know, it would, if this is going to be generalized to other bases, a super pumping lemma is suggested as being a challenge for that case. Then we can also philosophize a little bit about what we learned from problem one, if anything, on Thursday, and then we'll turn to problem two and get going on cryptanalysis. At least get the pump primed for cryptanalysis. Any questions? Excuse me for running over a little bit today. All right, okay, very nice.